वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर दिस गुड सेशन ऑफ प्रिकॉशंस इन क्लिनिक एंड डिस्पेंसरी इन कोविड सिचुएशन। एवरीथिंग इज टर्निंग अप टू नॉर्मलसी बट स्टिल सम क्लिनिक्स आर येट टू स्टार्ट। सम हैव ऑलरेडी स्टार्टेड आफ्टर लॉकडाउन। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ आईएमए सीजीपी विंग I welcome all of you for this session. In this session, we have stalwarts Dr. Avinash Bondwe, who is the president of Maharashtra State and needs no much introduction. A very dynamic leader, he has been awarded recently with Nepal government as Corona Warrior. Secondly, he is the representative in UNESCO for Maharashtra. He has written a lot of books and writing always in media. So also he is active throughout, I would say, in TV, radio, and all sorts of news agencies. And lot of questions has been answered by him. Who comes from the family physician, he has some queries, and Dr. Avinash Bondwe has the answer for that. Next, I would like to introduce Dr. Archana Pate, who is physician intensivist from Dombivli. She is medical director for a hospital, executive member for Maharashtra Medical Council, convener for Ethical Committee MMC, member of Bogus Doctors Enquiry Committee MMC, member of Negligence Committee Thane District, chairman Mission Pink Health, National Convener for Project Sanjeevani for CPR training, member of Ethic Committee at IMA headquarters, chairperson for a scientific committee, and she is the chairperson IMA MS Women's Doctors Wing. So, she would be briefing you about this today's session of precaution in clinic in this COVID situation and post-COVID situation. Next, I would introduce Dr. Ravindra Kute, who is a general surgeon, very senior consulting surgeon from Srirampur. He is a chairman of member of CGP wing, director, I would say, joint secretary IMA CGP headquarters also. So, with this introduction, I would ask Dr. Avinash Bondwe, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rajan Sancheti, and a very good morning to everybody. I also welcome our speaker, Dr. Archana Pate, and of course, all the other delegates and the chairman and founder of this DigiShield, Dr. Sanket Barley. Dear friends, as you all know, the medical practice is rather undergoing very much. So there are so many challenges we are facing. And the most important thing is that many of our colleagues, those who are running their dispensaries, the family physicians and the clinicians all across the Maharashtra, have inquired that there should be some guidelines or some discussion on reopening the medical practice. Because in the beginning of this COVID pandemic, we were instructed that attend only emergency thing and don't do the routine consultation. But after 3 months, the time has come that there is no thing like nothing is we cannot ask our patients to wait for further month or so. Because all those routine patients like diabetes, hypertension, osteoarthritis, and those who are taking long treatment, even the anemia and all those patients we come across in our family practice, as well as the most important thing in general practice, that for our patients, every complaint is emergency for him. Everybody must be quite aware that in midnight, you get calls that my child is having fever or I'm having fever. Just 10 minutes back, I got a frantic call that I got fever and loose motions, what should I do? So for our patients, every complaint, even a simple pain in abdomen, headache, is emergency. So now the problem we are facing, that how to tackle this, because of all these COVID epidemic pandemic situation, there are some restrictions about the infection control, about our own protections, and of course what we should do as per the guidelines, whether we should refer every patient, what we should do about those patients who come with fever. Shall we refer them immediately for COVID test, or shall we do some tests, or shall we tackle them in some way? How to differentiate all these? These are the problems we are facing. And along with that, there are so many things which we have to follow legally. So to discuss some of these things, we have organized this webinar on behalf of IMA Maharashtra State CGP. And I think all these people, all our participants will definitely be get benefited for this. So thank you very much. Dr. Sancheti, you can proceed.
Thank you, sir. Firstly, I would welcome Dr. Jayan Navarange, sir, join in the boardroom. Secondly, Hello, sir. Leshmukh. And I wanted to introduce Dr. Sanket Parle, who is the chairman of DigiShield. And this is a unique project of them for an app, so that we come to know whether the person is in COVID area, so that the doctor is gets alerted for that, and he would speak regarding that. Next, I would request Dr. Ravindra Kote, sir, say a few words and introduce.
Has he joined? Fine.
Till then, I would request Dr.
Good morning. Hello. Hello.
Yeah, please. Good morning. Please join, sir. Welcome, sir.
Good morning, everyone. I welcome all of you on this auspicious occasion. IMA CGP Maharashtra has conducted four webinars previously also. And today's topic is precautions in clinics and dispensaries in COVID situation is of utmost importance for clinicians, family doctors. Again, I will welcome all of you, and I think we should start with the lecture.
Session. May I request Dr. Arshana Patel, madam, to start her lecture, deliver her presentation.
Thank you, Sancheti, sir. Thank you, DigiShield, Bondwe, sir, Kute, sir, and hello, Navarange, sir. Basically, you know, now this is more or less turning officially announced, not announced, but I think we all know we are in the period of community transmission. In the period of community transmission, the first point of contact are always, always, always going to be the family physicians. In the frantic period which preceded what we are facing today, there were lots of discrepancies in the, you know, the guidelines that were being issued. Close the clinics, open the clinics, do this, do that. But everybody must now understand that somewhere or the other, sometime or the other time, we are going to have to start working, because the patient load is increasing drastically. And if the patient load is increasing drastically, then somewhere or the other, everybody will have to come into picture. First word of caution for all the senior members of IMA or all the senior doctors and all the doctors who are having comorbidities, blood pressure, diabetes, you know, any CKD or any like asthma, COPD, any of the chronic, even obesity has been now taken as a comorbidity. So any senior physicians, the guidelines say about 60, but I would say to be very sure about 55, please take care of yourself first. If you do not want to practice in this pandemic era, please go ahead and close the clinics, because you are very important. So that is the first word of caution to everybody. Now we go beyond that. So everybody somewhere or the other is going to have to start working in the pandemic era sooner or later. Now, certain things, if we follow, I think everybody will be reasonably doing well in their own clinics. Okay, there are certain infection control practices that everybody needs to follow in their own clinics or in their own OPDs to be able to protect themselves, their own staff members. Because that is our first point of concern, that we should not get infected and we should not be the point of transmission of infection. So the first criteria is to protect yourself and to protect your staff. So for that, you know, there are certain infection control practices if you follow, you will be reasonably doing okay in this pandemic scenario. One is you need not practice for your routine hours. You know, like if you were practicing initially, say for 5 hours in the morning, 5 hours in the evening, maybe you may not do that. You may practice for a fixed number of hours. You may sit for more number of hours, provided you are going to be taking calls and patients by appointments. And if you are spacing out your patients, and your appointments is very, very important. There should not be any rush in your OPD, basically. So if we see in a family physician's OPD, at any given time, there are 20 to 30 patients who are sitting in the OPD area. And the OPD area being small, it becomes very, very difficult, you know, to tell them to maintain social distancing or stay away or stand at a distance or wear a mask or, you know, everything is too difficult. So first thing is start taking appointments and see your OPD by appointments only. I think most of you are giving phone numbers to your patients. Try and avoid patients with very simple symptoms. If they have, you can consult them by telemedicine. Telemedicine has very much been approved by MMC. There are certain guidelines set for it. The patient has to be known to you. You may have to treat them for the diseases that you are aware of. Maybe your known patient for diabetes, hypertension, taking treatment from you regularly, and all you have to do is continuation of medicines. Go ahead and do a telemedicine. Simple treatment of, say, vomiting or some headache or something, you want to prescribe them treatment, do it by telemedicine. You have to write the prescription on your own letterhead with the complaints, with the prescription, your signature on it, and you can send it to them by WhatsApp. Charging, not charging, that is entirely your prerogative how you do it. So this is one aspect of it. In your own OPD, see to it that patients come by appointment. All patients have to maintain social distancing. At the entrance of your OPD, please place somewhere where they can sanitize their hands. No patient. Wearing a mask. Your receptionist may be inside, but try and appoint somebody who at the, you know, entrance of the clinic can triage the patients. Now, what is triaging basically? You are trying to differentiate between a probable COVID and patients with any other symptoms. Generally, the triaging means you are taking patient's temperature by infrared, or you are asking the patients for respiratory complaints, okay, and you are telling them probably, you know, they need to be seen differently compared to the other patients. If you are taking appointments on phone, you can always ask them if they are having fever or any respiratory complaints. Majority of the areas in Maharashtra have started having their fever clinics started by the government. So if you can direct the fever patients or patients with respiratory complaints to those OPDs, that will be more worthwhile. But if you cannot do it and that is your old patient who would like to show it to you, call them either at the start of the OPD or at the end of your OPD, when there is not much of a rush in your OPD. The patient needs to enter your OPD wearing a mask after sanitizing their hands, maintaining the social distance. When the patient enters your clinic, first thing when you enter your clinics, you should be dressed in a proper PPE. Now, what is a proper PPE? When you as a clinician, as a family practitioner, you are entering your own clinic area, one, let your consulting room, let your chamber be well ventilated. Avoid the practice of starting AC. Okay, if you have windows, nothing like it. If you have fans, nothing like it. Keep your room open, keep your fans on, keep the windows open, okay? That will increase the air ventilation in that area. Second, you need to wear N95 mask. You need to wear a face shield. Okay, you need to wear double gloves, and you can wear a plain cotton gown which is worn in the OT. That is also very much accepted because you are not going to be dealing with the body fluids of the patient. Okay, so for an OPD, this is an absolutely accepted guideline. For doffing, there are certain guidelines which you really need to follow. Okay, now it is difficult for me to tell you in a webinar how to go about a doffing sequence. But then while doffing, see to it that every time you are sanitizing. See, donning is not a problem. Your hands are sanitized, you have not seen any patients, you have not touched anything. Your gown has to be, after every use, it has to be dipped in soap and water. I would say hypochlorite, ideally 1% hypochlorite. But if 1% hypochlorite is not available, even soap and water solution would do. You have to dip it in that for say about half an hour or 1 hour and give it separately for washing. And after that, it can be reused after air drying. So when you are donning, that is wearing all the protective gear, you are absolutely in a sanitized area. You have not started seeing the patient as of then. Okay, your hands are good. You have not touched anything. So maybe donning you can do in any sequence which you think, right? But please remember, once you wear a mask, don't touching your mask again and again. During the OPD, the masks become itchy. You start itching around your nose area. Many doctors are also in a habit of putting the masks, under their nose area and keeping only the face area covered. This is absolutely unacceptable. Don't do this. Completely cover your nose and your mouth area. Try and buy N95 masks with a pin. There is a pin at the nose area. Once you wear it, press upon the pin so that it fits snugly and it would not slide down your mouth. Okay, otherwise it slides down and you continuously have to pull it to cover your nose area. Once you start the OPD, there should not be any touching of N95. There should not be touching of anywhere, even if you itch on your face area. You should not be touching your face area at all. Okay, your mobiles should be muted. Ideally, I would say shut off your mobile and put it in your bag. Use it only after you are leaving your OPD areas. Your assistant or your assistant can, answer on your mobiles and give appointments on the mobiles. But you do not be in the practice of using your mobiles because you are wearing your gloves. Even though you are sanitizing, you are supposed to use sanitizers between each patient. But still, if you are touching the patient, your gloves are supposed to be infected area. So with that, if you touch your mobile and put it on your face, you are going to be somewhere infecting your face area. So your face area has to be completely, kept untouched during your OPD hours. So this is the basic of, taking care of yourself. Now, between the patients, what are you supposed to do? Between the patients, between each patient that comes in, be in a habit of sterilizing your hand with hand sanitizer. Follow the 5 movements of hand sanitization. 1, if your gloves are soiled, you will need to change your gloves. But if your gloves are not soiled, the same glove, you change the upper glove, your inner glove remains like that, and you can just rewear a second glove on top of it if your glove is soiled. Between your patients, if your gloves are not soiled, you can just clean them with a sanitizer. For 20 seconds, you have to rub it in and follow the same 5 movements before the patient, after the patient. If you're doing any procedure, then before the procedure, after the procedure. These are the things which you will have to do it. Between the patients, if you're touching your patient with a stethoscope, the stethoscope diaphragm also has to be cleaned. Use BP apparatus, 1, which are automated if possible, okay, so that you do not have to continuously keep on putting the stethoscope in your ear. Automated BP apparatus are the best. If you are using automated BP apparatus, the cuff is made up of Rexin. So between the patients, you can clean again that with sanitizer. Okay, and you can just clean that, keep that, and reuse on another patient. Use this BP apparatus only on the patients, you feel that there is going to be a BP fluctuation, not on all the patients. Touching a stethoscope also on the patients where you really feel that the patient needs to be checked with stethoscope. What we are seeing is that the doctors are flatly refusing to use the BP apparatus on the patients, the stethoscope on the patients. Don't be scared. It is not that difficult. If you are worried, you can keep, there are chlorhexidine wipes which are available, though you feel they may be costly. But then you have to just tear off the chlorhexidine wipe, clean it, throw it, and it is as good as good to be used. So this is absolutely okay doing that. So this is about what you would do in your doctor's chamber. When the patient comes to you inside, if the patient is an adult patient, if the patient is able to tell you the symptoms, please do not allow any relative in your chamber, because our consulting rooms may be small and two people may crowd. Okay, try and make the patient sit at a distance of about, say across the chair, not very near to you. I would say 3 feet. If the patient is having respiratory symptoms, then at a distance of 6 feet. Now, I would just come in a short nutshell about the patients you feel are having any respiratory symptoms or having fever, basically. As I said, in majority of the areas, fever clinics are started by the government. If you can, please refer the patient to the fever clinics. If you can't, and patients are hiding the history of fever these days, patients are hiding the fever of malaise, myalgia, cough, cold, everything patient is hiding. So they will not be giving you any history. You have to really coax them into giving them symptoms. Cut down the total amount of time that you are spending on each patient. Don't give them too much of time. But during the period, the time that you are giving them, there are certain questions which you definitely need to ask them. One is if they come from a containment zone. Every area has got their containment zones published. You need to take them from your medical officer of health or the health officers that are looking after your area. They will be giving you containment zone lists. If you don't have it, please ask for it. Second, every patient that comes in, please ask them if they have come in contact with any positive patient, if they are running any fever if it is low grade, or if they are having any fevers which can suggest you viremia, body ache, headache, malaise, just weakness, a lot of fatigue, loose motions, sore throat, rhinorrhea, any of these features if they are having, please have a very high index of suspicion. The kind of phase that we are in, and probably in our area at least what we are seeing in last 3 to 4 days, any patient having a history of fever anywhere more than 48 hours, if you advise them COVID test, they are coming positive most of the times. So do not treat fever patients for a longer period of time. If a fever patient is coming to you, you may treat them for 1 or 2 days. But besides that, you may give them some antibiotic if you feel. You may give them, antiviral like Tamiflu or something if you want to give. Antihistaminics, fever medicines, cough medicines. But if the fever is lasting for more than 48 hours, please go ahead and prescribe COVID test. Nobody is going to tell you anything. The only thing is, while prescribing COVID test in private, you need to understand your prescription is supposed to have some details of patient's complaints, what you are prescribing, and what is your thought process behind me prescribing the COVID test. Okay. Now, government is coming very strictly as to every doctor has to inform the fever patients to the authorities. I do not know how many areas have received this communication. In Thane, 20 clinics have been sealed of doctors, that has not been very specified. But 20 clinics of family physicians have been sealed because they indiscriminately went on treating the fever patients and they failed to inform the government authorities. Okay, so in areas where there is a high transmission rate, they have come out with notifications that fever patients are to be informed to the government authorities. I will just tell you what we have been asked to do in KDMC area. If the patient is reluctant to go to the fever clinic, and if the general practitioner wants to prescribe fever tests in private, they can very well do it. But at the end of the day, they are supposed to send a mail of which fever patients they have seen and they have prescribed the COVID test, not all fever patients, by mail to the KDMC authorities. So this is what we are doing in our area, or we are asking our GPs to do in our area. So please, have some coordination with the medical officers in your area, the medical officers or health officers in your area. There are epidemic officers appointed in all areas, and they are in charge of taking the fever patient details from you. Okay, Now, any patient, if you have advised COVID test, the patient will come back to you with the COVID report. Please understand, the COVID reports are informed by the laboratories. Legally, they are bound to inform your local authorities, but you are also legally bound to inform your local civic bodies. Okay, so from your end also, an information is supposed to go there. Okay, so this is all about the patients and the care that you are supposed to be taking in your OPDs. If you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer.
Madam, for your nice presentation. There are a few questions.
Yes.
Which need to be taken care of. Indications for COVID testing and authorized laboratories.
See, authorized laboratories, I will come to first, is I do not know if there are different laboratories which are permitted in different areas. I can tell you about the laboratories which permissions we have come across. Thyrocare, Metropolis, Infection, we have a Krishna lab over here, Suburban Diagnostics. So these are the labs that we are aware of. Again, I'm telling you that please contact your local health authorities, because local health authorities have, the IMA office bearers can do this. You know, they can take, they can contact the local health authorities and from them take a list of the approved laboratories which are there in your area and circulate amongst your members. So that is the first thing which I would tell you. The second thing is the government laboratories which we are talking about. The government is also doing COVID tests and sending them to their government approved laboratories. But that is, if I'm mistaken, it is done only through the fever clinics or the patients who are approaching the government hospitals or the government authorized centers, not for all the patients who go from private OPDs. So this needs to be definitely emphasized to your members. Second thing I've already covered in my presentation, that fevers, anything lasting for more than 48 hours, please take it as COVID unless proven otherwise. Go ahead and advise them COVID test. Patients at times are not presenting with complaints. Okay, and that viremia is like any viremia that you get, fatigue, weakness, malaise, headache, body ache, sore throat, rhinorrhea, anything. So anywhere they say something which is out of the ordinary, do suspect COVID. Okay. Now, what is happening is COVID is seen to have a biphasic presentation. There are patients who just do not present at the initial symptoms of this, you know, that viremic phase that we are talking about. That is malaise or the viremic features. But they directly present after a few days in the second phase, wherein they are presenting with breathlessness, or they are presenting with cough, or they are presenting with severe malaise, severe body ache, or severe weakness. So please, in patients who are presenting with severe weakness, severe malaise, or you know, severe lethargy, or again ongoing fever, please, you have to be very cautious. Know the containment areas. Ask your patients if they have come in contact with any COVID positive patients. The community transmission is definitely on. So do not be relying only on the travel history. Your travel history will also include if patient is going from one district to another district or from one city to another city, that is also going to be considered as a travel history. Any healthcare worker, that is all of us, so any healthcare workers who develop influenza like symptoms, okay, influenza like symptoms is any viremic features having even low grade fever, they may need to be on a more watch, okay, for COVID. They need to wait for the symptoms to subside in 2 days, 3 days time, or consult a consultant in your area and see if you need to get yourself tested for COVID. So for all healthcare workers, they need to be cautious for a development of influenza-like symptoms. You may not have come in contact with a non-COVID positive patient, but as I said, if the community transmission is on and 80% of the patients are supposed to be asymptomatic, okay? So you will not come to know if you have already encountered a COVID positive patient. So anybody may pass on the infection to you. So any healthcare workers needs to be more watchful. asymptomatic contact of a COVID positive patient. Like in a family, there are 5 patients, 2 patients have come positive, 3 patients do not have any symptoms. They're totally asymptomatic. Now these 2 patients have been tested today and found to be positive. For asymptomatic patients, do not advise COVID test immediately. Generally, this is followed up by the healthcare workers. But if they asked you on phone, doctor, what I should do, ask them for a COVID test between 5th to 14th day of the last contact, if they are asymptomatic and not before that. If patient is symptomatic, you can ask for a COVID test immediately. For asymptomatic contacts of a COVID positive patient, the time when you do a COVID test is between 5th to 14th day of the contact. I think I've made it clear. So if you have any, if you have not understood yet about this, please ask me.
Madam, some clinics have been sealed in our rural area called Lawle, Kirangut. And the doctors were in dilemma because after the sealing, when to start? It should be 48 or 72 hours. There were no perfect guidelines. And they told to quarantine at least for 14 days. All staff have been done, tested for COVID. They were negative. How many days they can again start their clinics?
Sir, actually, that's what I'm saying. See, if you everybody is in a PPE, okay, then the clinic, if a patient comes positive, if you are a COVID negative area, if a patient has come positive, informed, then probably they ask you to just sanitize your area, close it down for 48 hours, and then you can restart. Okay, now if your staff has come in, like if you have a hospital, probably, and you have a COVID positive patient, means who's detected to be COVID positive in your area, but everybody has been PPE, again the procedure is the same. Now in areas where your staff is not in PPE, you may ask to be sealed down. So that's why I'm telling you that everybody please be in a habit of using PPE. In a non-COVID area, the PPE does not mean the hazmat suits. The PPE does not mean wearing your ATGSM non-disposable overalls and all that. In a non-COVID area where you are not taking COVID-positive patients, even an OT gown, OT coverall, which is covering you completely, double gown, a cap, N95 face mask, and a shield should do. Okay, but if you're not using any of this and your patient comes positive, they will ask you to seal your area. Now the guidelines have changed. They do not ask you to seal and quarantine your staff for 14 days. They tell you that test your staff after 5 days of the contact. Okay, like what I said about asymptomatic contacts of positive patients, the healthcare workers who treat patients without proper protection, they fall in the high risk category. And that's why they have to, quarantine themselves for at least 5 to 7 days. The healthcare owner, the facility owner should get them tested after 7 days for the swab. If the swab comes negative, you can always inform the healthcare authorities and request your setup to be restarted. So there are different guidelines for COVID areas and non-COVID areas.
One thing I would like to ask you, ma'am. There are some PP kits which are reusable, used from the synthetic gown or like our raincoat or windshields. Can we use that instead of this thing? They are reusable. After every session, can we sterilize it and use it?
Or disinfect it? There are certain very, glazed, how we would have this rice kagumis. So those kind of PPEs are available, which they say are reusable. But again, I'm telling you that in OPD, there is no need for using these disposable PPEs. In OPD, what you need is something to cover you completely, basically, because you are not going to be coming in contact with body fluids of the patient. The areas where there is aerosol generation, okay? So no nebulizations in your clinics at all, zero nebulizations in your area. Any aerosol generating procedures if you do, that is nebulizations, or if you do intubation, okay, suctioning is done. These are all aerosol generating areas which are generally ICU setups or areas where positive patients are kept ready. You are going to have to use the proper PPEs, disposable PPEs. in your clinics, as long as you do not have this practice of using nebulizations, okay, and any breathless patient, okay, the dictum is please do a COVID test. Okay, do a COVID test. Do not wait for the fever.
My suggestion was using the cotton gowns and disinfecting them is not practically possible for most of the family physicians and clinicians. Every time they have to take it home or something, there is no facility available in a clinic, in a small clinic, to this thing. So it's better if we can use this type of synthetic this thing. Is it okay?
Sir, the thing is that even if you are wearing a disposable PPE, which you are saying that you sterilize and use it.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm getting repeated phone calls because, as I'm saying, for last 4-5 days, the number of cases have increased so drastically that every 2 minutes a phone call is coming. See, somewhere you will have to doff it. Somewhere you will have to remove your coveralls. You will have to put it in 1% hypochlorite. Yeah. You will have to wash it, and the same procedure is there for any coverall that you wear.
Okay.
So it is no different.
Whichever you use.
And the second thing is whether it is reusable or no will depend upon the manufacturer's guidelines. Not all coveralls or what you are saying, the disposable fabrics, all of them are washable and reusable.
Madam, I have one question. Yeah. The person tested positive, COVID positive, after 7 days the patient is discharged on 7 days without doing a second test, and they are sent home. They are asked to do home quarantine, extra is fine. But in that building, there could be several other family members, or there could be some other tenements also. So how far it is safe? Because 100% quarantine and the person remaining inside is practically not possible in many of the situations. And we are sending them home without a second test.
Sir, what is actually now, there are lots of studies which are coming in, which are say that by the 9th or the 10th day, the patient may be RT-PCR positive. Okay, the RT-PCR positivity has been noted up to even 48 days.
Yes.
But patient after 9th or 10th day is no longer infected.
Okay. So 10 days.
The studies are telling.
10 days should be a good period.
Yes, 10 days is actually the period. Yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
So that's why the guidelines are that if the patient is afebrile for 3 days, if the patient is not needing any oxygen support or not breathless for about 3 days, or 10 days from the RT-PCR, the patients are discharged. The repeat swab is generally done for the patients who have come from ICU. Generally, the repeat swabs are not done for the patients who are just kept in a COVID care center.
Yeah.
Two more questions have come.
Sir, can I interrupt for a minute?
Yeah.
I'm getting call from our medical officer of health.
Please
go ahead. Can I be excused for 5 minutes?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, I'll just join back in 5 minutes.
Till then, Dr. Bonnevay can guide us.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. I'll just join back in 5 minutes.
Bonnevay, sir, don prashna prashna. Should a doctor aged 65 attend his clinic in these days or get retirement and stay home? This was actually a question of one of my friends who has, but this has come on YouTube just now.
Yeah.
So many of my classmates, and they are asking, they are running general practice at Moshi, somebody is doing at Loni. So they're fine. They want to attend. But the family members are very afraid. Send the person, if he is otherwise okay, absolutely fit.
Sir, right now, there is no official instruction or any official declaration either from government or from ICMR or from the central government that after this age, the doctor should not practice or they are exempted from the practice. The only thing, I myself in a television interview had asked our health minister that whether our 65 year old above that with comorbidities can be exempted. So that was an assurance on television that he said that it is they can be exempted. And secondly, there was one notification by Director of Medical Education. They were needing around 25,000 doctors all over Mumbai, two districts of Mumbai. that time he had given instructions that they want doctors below the age of 55 years. They are exempted above 55 years. They are exempted with comorbid people, comorbid conditions. And those lady doctors who are pregnant and having a kid up to 1 year. So these are all we are thinking that they are exempted, but there is no official clear-cut guideline. On the other hand, we have said that above 65 should not come, but there is no official standing for that. And secondly, on the other hand, if we keep our clinics closed, they may give us notices that under Epidemic Act that you have kept your clinic closed. So we inquired about that. So this is, you can say, the not very official this thing. But on unofficially, these notices will be sent to the Medical Council, Maharashtra Medical Council. And Maharashtra Medical Council will decide. So it's up to the Maharashtra Medical Council may give us some relief. That above 65 or above 55 year people cannot practice or they can be exempted. Right now, there is no official guideline. Secondly, it's up to sir family members. Many of our doctors have rather accepted that their family members say that please do not go as per their own value, as well as they may get infected because of those people. Because of the doctors, the family members may get infected. So it's rather our individual decision, sir, whatever you feel like. But the thing is that there is no official guideline from the government or from the ICMR or even from the medical council that below this age, above this age, you are exempted, or with comorbid conditions, you are exempted. They are all assumptions, sir. Yeah.
Sir, what I would suggest here, can I just interrupt?
Yes,
sir. What I would suggest is, you know, that everybody who's having a comorbidity and they wish to withdraw themselves from any services, let them write an official letter on their letterhead and give it to the local authorities and tell them that I, because of these comorbidities, I'm keeping my clinics closed and I may please be allowed. Because tomorrow, if it comes to anything going to MMC or something like that, you know, they can always say that we have submitted and let them take a received the inward this of whatever letter they are submitting.
Yeah, one more thing, Dr. Navrange sir said about the home quarantine. Now the government has declared that the person with asymptomatic persons who are COVID positive and with mild symptomatic patients, they can be kept at home. As per the guidelines, they say that 17 days quarantine, the person has to give this undertaking to the government officer, and then they follow up this thing. Our problem is, in my clinic, suppose I diagnose somebody who is asymptomatic and having all these this COVID test positive, can I send him can I advise him home quarantine? Or it is up to the government medical officer's discretion?
Sir, you have to, once your patient comes positive, as I said, you have to tell it to the local authorities.
Yeah, that is okay.
Second, your responsibility ends at that. Okay, if your patient's house is big, you can tell them to contact the local health authorities and you tell them, because they are supposed to be giving an undertaking to the medical officers. So we have no role to play over there. Once the government officers, if their house is big, you know, they have a separate room, a separate bathroom, which only the patient uses, and they are going to be able to isolate themselves separately and follow certain guidelines, like certain tests are to be done or pulse oximeter is to be checked. You may only give them guidance on phone, because that is where our role comes in as a doctor. Other than that, they have to request the health authorities that I have so and so. There is no objection, you know, for my being quarantined from my say residence areas, this, that, whatever, the building tenants or whatever. and I would like to be kept quarantined at my own home, and I am willing to give you the undertaking. So then it becomes the health officer and the patient. We have no role to play.
That is okay. One suggestion I would like to have from your side, that can we ask government, see, right now the situation is, in all the hospitals are full, especially in all these hotspots and Pune, Mumbai, Thane belt. The hospitals are full, they are not having doctors. So this is one of the options that they are asking for home quarantine. Now, the home quarantine is of course to follow up, for their follow up, they are not sufficient medical officers with the government. So can we, as Indian Medical Association, can we ask that as you have asked us to join for the COVID duties, we will be able to do this home follow-up of whole quarantine people. So is it possible?
Sir, actually, this is what we have suggested in our area, that, you know, all those doctors, senior doctors, you know, who are not going to be able to help us actively on the field. So, you know, they can take up the role of guiding the people on phone. Now, the thing is that what happens, sir, the problem is that you have to give either your personal phone number or you have to give a dedicated phone number which the patients are going to be using for this. Now, all big hospitals, say Apollo Hospital, Fortis Hospital, you know, they have come up with this home quarantine packages, if you're aware of. These home quarantine packages, they will give you teleconsultation with nurse, they will give you teleconsultation with doctors, they will provide you pulse oximeters, laser thermometers. You have to take everything and you have to inform, and the doctor and the nurse guides you, and they give you a designated time period wherein you are supposed to be contacting these designated, you know, if you have taken that package. Now, our problem becomes what? That our patients know discipline only when they pay big chunks of money. If they don't pay big chunks of money, they do not know discipline. So if you say that contact me only during this time, or, you know, our doctors will be providing services or teleconsultation, say during some few hours in the morning and some few hours in the evening, how will you restrict the calls on the other times? One thing. Second thing, you cannot, as Indian Medical Association, it becomes difficult to ask for charges from patients, because patients are looking at a lot of honorary services. So if somebody is doing it at individual basis, then it becomes an individual thing. If you would like to assist the government or your local authorities in any which ways as Indian Medical Association, it would be a very welcome step, actually. But then, you know, the whole scenario needs to be worked out, considering all the pros and cons.
One thing I must explain, that we all, the family physicians, or even the physicians like you, those patients who are having our number, they never follow the time rule. They can call us anytime. And secondly, we never ask money from them. So we can utilize this as a some sort of social commitment.
What can be done in certain places, what has been done, you know, 4-4 hour slots have been given to doctors.
Yeah.
So within this 4 hours, one doctor will be attending phone calls. Next 4 hours, other doctor will be attending phone calls. Like that, 24 hours are divided. So if that kind of things can be done, like for this 4 hours slot, 3 numbers are given. For next 4 hours slot, 3 numbers are given. So patients can contact. So then others are not harassed. Not harassed, I will not say harassment. But then basically, you know, there are people have lots of, even we doctors have lots of queries. So patients who are totally unaware, so they are going to be having really, really, for the same fever, for the same cough, they will call you 10 times, which is at times becomes difficult to get.
There are two questions. First thing, someone has asked of doffing and donning protocol. Secondly, related to that, if someone uses the mask, if he has itching on the nose and face, if it is unavoidable, you find it amusing, but can we remove the glove, sanitize the hand, and do the itching after that, after removing the mask? And
It is most unadvisable. Most unadvisable. I mean, that is the way in which you can definitely infect yourself, whatever said and done. During the OPD hours, even if you remove the top glove, sanitize the under glove, or remove both the gloves, wash your hands, but your face area itself, you have not washed. So you may just from one area, you may put it to your nose. So that is the most unacceptable thing you can do during the OPD hours. So just try and avoid that as much as you can. For whatever the worth it is, what I will say is try to remove the nasal hair. Though it provides a filter, that becomes one of the causes for itching. It gives you a lot of itching during that time. Second is, if you are itching in any which ways, okay, on the mask, you may, just do this. Again, it is unacceptable, unavoidable rahega, karo, but most unadvisable. Don't do that.
Right.
Like someone has asked, whether we can we give TT injection? Because there are a lot of injuries. And TT injection. We routinely give, but someone asks the precautions to be taken.
Any injection, you mean?
For
any injection.
So it remains the same. Sir, I think, Bondwe sir, would you like to answer?
Yeah. Actually, see, we have been promoting and we are sure all our members, all our IMA CGP members are quite convinced that injection practice is not rather very good thing. And previously, about a generation back, every patient used to ask injection for anything, whether he has any pain right from his toe to head or any problem. Giving injection was this thing. But for last so many years, we are advising that giving injection is not a good practice. It has got no role. There are very few indications in which a general practitioner has to give injections, like this vaccination, or maybe a patient is having severe colic, severe pain, or maybe vomiting. These type of indications, in such indications, we have to rather give injection. But as Dr. Archana Pate madam said, we have to be fully protected doing this, while doing this injection, giving this injection as far as possible, avoid. But when it is absolutely important to give that injection, then you have to use all that gloves, PP kits and everything, because you will be going quite nearer to the patient, you will be touching and this thing. And is it, madam, that after giving some injection, should we change the gloves and wear the new disposable?
See, if you have that, the guidelines are the same. If your gloves are soiled, then you change it. If your gloves are not soiled in any which ways, you can just do, sterilization by hand sanitizer.
Yeah. And one more thing, similarly, I would like to ask that sometime back we had discussed that, first thing is N95 masks are not available in good, this thing. They are not available properly. Right now, even in Pune, we are not getting this thing regularly. Secondly, costly. So most of our clinicians, especially our general practitioners in rural area or in remote area, they are asking whether it is reusable, or is there any guideline that you said about whatever is done in N? Is there any guideline still prevailing that you can reuse the N95 mask?
Sir, actually for N95, it is use and throw. Generally what they say is use it for one shift and throw it. But then, because as you rightly said, there is a scarcity of masks, so CDC as well as AIIMS has come up with, this kind of scenario, and they said that you can have 7 masks or you can have 5 masks. If you're using your OPD, you're working for say 5 days or 6 days, you can have 6 masks. At your home, have 6 somewhere where you can hang those masks. So air drying, basically, that is the whole idea. Let the mask be air dried. Use one and number them day 1, day 2, day 3, day 4, day 5, day 6. So on day 1, use one mask, come hang it. Removal of the N95 mask in itself has a process which needs to be followed. You are supposed to be removing the lower strap first and then the upper strap. Don't jerkily remove it. You are supposed to be removing it very smoothly, not facing anybody. Look down and remove it. And then just hang it on some place where you have it to hang. And then you can, yes. And then 6 days, you can reuse it. They say 5 times you can reuse the mask. Okay, so in that way, your whole month goes on probably 6 masks. And then after that, you discard and remove a new lot of 6 masks.
But remember, this is just a tip, a practical tip.
Jugaad, what we are doing. Yeah. And if you wear a face shield, probably then this may be acceptable.
Yeah. Sanchiti sir, please unmute yourself. Sanchiti sir, unmute yourself.
Healthcare workers be given raincoat.
Sir, I think this is the same question as what Bonwe sir had asked about this week.
We have a
practitioner here, you know, like we have seen their photos, very senior practitioners. And because initially when this pandemic started, there was like a lot of scarcity of PPEs. So they were wearing these PPEs, instead of PPEs, they were wearing these raincoats and the N95 mask and everything and the gloves and everything. See, sir, I will tell you only one thing. You are not only coming in contact with patients in these 4 hours of what you're seeing clinics. Rest 20 hours are also there. Generally, we feel that only during our OPD practice, we are coming in contact with a COVID positive patient. So rest 20 hours, we are really slightly relaxed. Please remember, whatever you do, you just cover your body. That is the whole principle. Cover your body. Do not allow anything to come in contact with your body. While you are removing what you are wearing, you have to do it in a way that, you know, there is not going to be a sudden jerky movement of the cloth that you have removed, which will, you know, spread anything in the air around you. After removing, again, whatever is to be disposed, like gloves and all, dispose it properly. Whatever you feel you are going to be reusing, they are supposed to be dipped properly in a soap or a hypochlorite solution, washed and to be reused after air drying. Rest 20 hours, do not relax. The rule is simple. Wherever you go out, you are always wearing a mask which is covering your mouth and your nose. No touching of your nose. Your hands are not supposed to be coming in contact. You will touch here and there and touch your nose and your mouth, and that is the time when you are going to be infected. As long as you don't do this, you are going to be reasonably safe. So please follow this practice. Rest of the times whenever you are awake, barring the time when you are sleeping.
Madam, I would like to ask you a question. Since you're a respectable member of MMC, so this question is, Dr. Navrangi is also there. Please call him also. Yeah, madam, I'm rather talking to so many general practitioner, family physicians, and even clinicians. Some of them have asked me that as per see, they are all practicing from 20 to 35, 40 years. So they say that whenever a patient comes in, they know and they talk to him. They know what are things to be done and what medicines to be given. So is it possible, on one side, we are accepting the telemedicine. So in my clinic, suppose I ask the patient to sit, say, around 2 meters distance. I talk to him, take his history in detail. And if I just, without clinically examining the patient, clinical examination, of course, is a partly thing because the inspection also comes in the clinical listing. Absolutely. Is it possible that we can practice this way for a few days, or especially for the fever patients?
Sir, you will have to learn to do that. Because this is now everybody will have to learn to do that.
Yeah.
Okay. Your contact with the patient has to be minimized. Do not try to palpate everybody. Do not try to auscultate everybody. Go more by the detailed history. Okay. Go more by your inspection. Okay. Go more by non-touch techniques. Only where you really feel that you need to touch. If the patient is having abdominal pain, if you feel that you can prescribe medicines, go ahead and do it. You feel the pain is severe. What more things are we going to achieve by auscultating? Please ask a sonography.
Yeah.
Are you understanding? So everybody will have to learn to maintain social distancing, because our role is to guide basically. Patients do not know what to do in that scenario. Our role is as their guides. We have to tell them what proper things are to be done. We can do that even maintaining a social distance. You do not have to touch all the patients every time. We will have to, but mention it on paper.
Yeah.
Okay, that because of this corona pandemic, the patient, but then, you know, there are instances where patients are breathless and they are being treated on OPD basis. Yesterday, I have had a patient who has come to me with a saturation of 70, 70. and the patient has been treated for breathlessness for 4 days in the OPD by giving injectables. Now, these are totally unacceptable, methods of practicing in the present current pandemic scenario. Whatever you are doing, please mention it on paper. If you are very sure of what you are doing, go ahead and put it on paper. Explain it to the patient's relatives that because of this, we are doing this. And if you are having any doubts, get the patient investigated. That is the best way to practice right now.
Or we can put on...
You should. Yes. Patient not...
We'll put up on OTC also. Yeah. Explaining
so as and when needed. Yes. As and when needed, the detailed clinical examination will be done. Because what is happening, patients, even hypertensive patients, if they are complaining of, visual disturbances or headaches or, any giddiness or something, their BPs are not being checked. Now, these are the things which we cannot do. There we have to check the blood pressure. So that's why I said use automated BP machines which are having Rexin cuff, which you can sanitize. And they are not very costly. They cost you about 2,500, 3,000 rupees, much safer than what you would do in your routine OPD practice, putting a stethoscope in your ear.
But the fear in the mind of our practitioners is that if I just with the history and the inspection, I examine the patient and something goes wrong, then will it be considered as an act of negligence or like that?
Sir, you have to be clinically sound. You have to be really sure. Where you are unsure, please refer the patient to a higher center.
Okay.
Where they will be in a better way, better suited or better in PPEs and everything, where they will be in a better position to take care of the patient. So, when in doubt, please refer the patient to a higher center.
Okay.
Can we practice in containment zone? What are the rules?
So containment zones, the rules are the same. The rules are not different. The fevers in containment zones, influenza-like symptoms in containment zones, do not take them lightly. You have to refer them for either COVID testing or refer to your local fever clinics, which are run by the government. Because if you miss on these, then you are in a problem.
But right now, and please, my knowledge, the clinics and dispensaries in the containment zone are not supposed to be open. They have to be kept closed.
So that we have to work out as per the government guidelines.
Yeah.
Because all local authorities issues the guidelines.
Yeah.
So as per the government guidelines, we have to do. And everywhere, please, with the local authorities, develop a system for all the family physicians to inform the fever cases what they see and what cases they are referring for COVID testing from their end, if they are referring in private.
What is cutoff level of oxygen saturation in a symptomatic patient, ma'am?
Sir, 95 to 96 is a good saturation, but please remember there is something called as a walk test. Okay, make the patient walk around for about 5 minutes and recheck the saturation.
Okay.
If there is a fall in saturation by 2 or 3, okay, then please take it as that the patient is desaturating and refer to a higher center. Okay.
What about exposure through eye shield or sealed eyeglasses?
Exposure.
Exposure through eye shield or sealed eyeglasses.
Sir, you have to wear an N95 mask even if you are using a shield. Because in some places, what we have seen is they are using face shields as the only protection. Or they are wearing, a simple your surgical mask and the eyeglasses. Rest of the face may be exposed, but then if you have a habit of touching and doing this and itching, then it is absolutely bad. Your face shield, whenever you are using, you can, if they are reusable, you can clean them either with sanitizer or you can wash them with soap and water, allowed to air dry and reuse it.
Okay. And there's, if there is a death due to non-COVID cause, do you have to do COVID test done? Is the COVID test to be done if there is death?
Sir,
we don't know whether there is comorbidity.
You will not be doing anything because you do not know whether it was a COVID death or not. Your job is to inform the police. Now the guidelines have changed for these non-COVID deaths. If there is really thought of, the police thinks it is non-COVID, they will do a panchanama and they will allow, to be given a DC. But then that is not at your end. Your job is to inform the police.
Dr. Kutte sir, any questions from your side? Kutte sir is there? Any more questions?
If there are no questions, I would like to request one thing about some similar activities which doctors can do. The questions are over, Dr. Sancheti.
There was a question in OPD, do you need to wear gown? Madam,
that all no, those questions we are already answered, just no need to. Madam, our general practitioners, they have minimum around 40 patients per session. They practice morning, evening. Even in COVID days, in periphery, I'm coming across so many of our colleagues are having still conducting an OPD of 100 patients and all that. So all these precautions they will have to take, they have to restrict and all that. But considering the volume of this practice, is it possible to do some sort of you can say some study or some survey, especially the sero survey? Can you
the sero survey is something which we are in the process of already in Dombivli. Through IMA Dombivli, our ICMR application has already gone. Okay, the sero survey, what we are talking about, the only thing which is allowed is the surveillance tactics which have been approved by ICMR and not others. Okay, so there are certain surveillance like for sero survey, what the ICMR had asked for was a COVID Kavach ELISA test. Okay, which is not available to general public, which is not available to even doctors, rather it is not available in the market. So if that survey has to be done, it is carried out only with ICMR. So that is about sero survey. So if anybody, we are already in the process, our ethical committee clearance is pending. Other than that, we have got in principle approval for that. So if we are able to carry it out at our end, we will, you know, guide you as to how we can, you know, probably enforce the model across Maharashtra.
Can we expand your survey for the
Maharashtra? That's what I'm saying, sir. That's what I'm saying. See, they have given me a limited number. We have sought an approval for 500 sample study. In that, we are adding all the doctors who are working in DCH, dedicated COVID hospital and dedicated COVID healthcare centers, and all the health officers who are doing ground survey. So that is one sample, and the members of our IMA Dombivli, those who want to enroll themselves for such a sero survey. So we have given a study sample of 500, and we are awaiting approval of the ethical committee. So once that approval of ethical, because it needs a lot of you know, things which need to be worked out at the ground level. So if our things materialize, then we definitely, you know, it is like something which I feel personally which needs to be done in healthcare professionals, and we will definitely guide you know, the doctors of Maharashtra and IMA Maharashtra state as to how we can implement this in the rest of Maharashtra.
Thank you very much.
Next, Dr. Bondwe sir, I'd like to inform exactly, you may be knowing, this is for general practitioners and other those who are attending. We have kept about 3 hotels for quarantine reserved for IMA members. Secondly, 3 hospitals are also there. Hospitals we have reserved. I mean, 2% of the cases, they can be shifted to those hospitals, those who need, I would say, more care. So from IMA Pune, I would like to share this information. Next, I hope all the questions have been solved. Next, there was again one, I would say, last question. What about the cash collection and clinic and floor disinfection?
Cash collection, you can opt for Google Pay. Now many, you know, digital payment modes are available, or probably you can keep a box over there, you know, wherein the patients can just deposit money. With lockdown, we are seeing that many of the patients are not able to really, you know, do cash payments, and they do opt for credit card, debit cards, or, you know, the other digital modes of payment. So I will suggest that everybody should be having some mode of digital payment facility available. That is one aspect of it. And second question was disinfection. Okay. So disinfection, as I said, between the OPD, I've already said, between 2 patients, you need to sanitize your hands with hand sanitizer, what to do about the BP apparatus, what to do about the diaphragm of the stethoscope, that I've already said. Your terminal cleaning has to be done of all the surfaces which the patient has utilized. So there are hypochlorite solutions available. You have to dilute them and make it up to 1% hypochlorite solution. And the entire surfaces have to be cleaned with 1% hypochlorite solution after your, you know, your clinics are over. So that is the terminal disinfection that you do.
Dr. Sancheti, I would like to explain about this cash collection. Since this is a very common question usually asked to us, especially by the shopkeepers and other those who handle cash in lot, of course our general practitioners. The practical problem is our the patients we come across, they do not have credit cards or they do not have any online or digital payment system, and we have to take cash. So the answer is just remember the basic preventive methods. Once you touch the currency notes, you have to wash your hands before touching your face. It is like that. Even if you take that money at home, and then even that you can keep it in a box, but after touching the currency notes, don't touch your face, nose, or eyes before washing it properly for 20 seconds. So that is the one answer. Because I have come across so many. Even the these businessmen, they are washing the currency notes. They are even ironing the currency notes before using. So that is not the correct method and not possible every time, especially for doctors. So don't think that, that people are thinking that this COVID-19 virus is all over this thing, and they are also currency is the main thing. There are so many people are also believing that using these papers and this thing. These newspapers. So all these things, just whatever you touch, don't touch your face before washing. That is the only thing.
And after everything, follow 7 steps of hand hygiene. Very important. Please follow the 7. Just don't, you know, put soap and just rub it and wash it off. Do not do that. The 7, because in a day now my hands are having, you know, we are having so much of dryness and itchiness. Because after seeing COVID patients, because I am giving my services to one dedicated COVID hospital, I mean, the number of times that we wash hands, it is now going to a sort of irritation that it is unbelievable number of times we are washing our hands. Every time, your 7 steps of hand hygiene, there are YouTube videos available. There are, you know, lots of material available. It is very simple, you know, front, your backs, between your fingers, your fingertips, your this, between your thumb has to be washed separately and the wrist has to be washed. Every time you do count 10, you know, it's like they say 40 seconds, but you really count 40 seconds. You can't count 40 seconds. So just say in your mind and then it becomes a habit. What you do, it becomes a habit. You know, so every time you count 10 initially and then you know what you have done is right. Okay, so just this 7 steps of hand hygiene, see to it that you are following, and that will be going a long way in keeping you away from COVID.
Yeah. There is one suggestion by one of our professors that when we celebrate a birthday, we say happy birthday to you. That song exactly takes 20 seconds. So whenever you wash your hands, think of somebody you like.
Sir, hand wash is not 20 seconds, sir. Hand wash, ideal hand wash is 40 seconds, not 20 seconds.
Can think
when
about
you do a sanitizer, when you are using hand sanitizer, that is 20 seconds.
Yeah.
When you are doing a proper hand wash, it is 40 seconds.
Yeah. So we have to remember all our first surgical term things which were told to us. So the my this thing that before washing your at the time of washing your hands, think of somebody you like and wish him or her a happy birthday for 40 seconds and continue your washing.
What are the antiviral doses? Someone has asked. Antiviral.
About what? You have to be very
routine. Specific. Should we give? There is, I mean, patient of cold.
Sir, as I said, 1 or 2 days if there is a patient of fever. Are you really going to prescribe antiviral in all patients that come with cough? We generally give antihistaminics or we give, you know, your cough suppressants or whatever you want to give. So we really do not give antivirals also to all the patients. You may want to give it to patient who comes with, you know, like more of fever, malaise, low-grade fever, malaise, or somewhere where you are thinking in terms of viremia. So again, as I said, for a day or two, you want to give oseltamivir, please give, because that is the only thing which you can give in clinic. You cannot give favipiravir, which is now recognized treatment for the milder COVID patients. You cannot prescribe them from your OPD.
Okay.
Unless you are going to, if the relative comes to you, the patient has been allowed to stay in home quarantine, okay, and then, you know, patient is coming to you with prescription, but you are going to be in contact. Yeah, and you are going to be taking responsibility of the patient. Am I audible? Sorry, I had a phone call.
Yes, yes.
So only in that case, you can prescribe them Fabiflu. Fabiflu is favipiravir. So on your prescription, you have to write, you can prescribe it only for COVID positive patients who are having mild symptoms, not requiring oxygen, not desaturating, even walk test, probably, because if anything of that is coming, after walk test, the patient is desaturating, no home treatment. The patient has to go to a consultant, get admitted and get treated. So till then, if any positive patient, mildly symptomatic patient you want to prescribe, 200 milligram tablets of Fabiflu are available. Day one dose is 1800 milligram. Okay, that is 9 tablets in the morning, 9 tablets in the evening, day one. Day two onwards, it is 4 tablets morning, 4 tablets evening. From day 2 to day 5, you will have to monitor LFTs on the patient. Remember, it's a new drug. It is relatively very, very high dose. And we really do not have a complete side effect profile of this drug. So you will have to be very careful when you prescribe it.
Most important thing will be our colleague doctors should not try them on their own.
Treatment do not do.
No.
Please, yeah. Once you have a COVID, one word of advice. See, now I will use this platform for our healthcare workers, all doctors. What we are seeing right now is our majority of the healthcare workers are self-treating themselves, avoiding to go to for RT-PCR testing. Unfortunately, what is happening, the initial phase will wear off without giving you any more symptoms. If unfortunately you land up in the second phase, you know, where this lung inflammation and everything starts, you do not have a COVID report in hand. Your CT scan and all you may do, which will show ground glass opacity. There is a lot of problem in admitting such patients. No hospital is admitting COVID suspect patients, even when they are desaturated. So you are always in your dilemma, what am I supposed to do? Your test may come negative, may come positive. Even if it comes positive, it is like knowing a known enemy. You know that you are having this enemy and you are supposed to be watchful. So know your enemy, know that you are COVID positive, seek help in time. This is such a different scenario. But if in this time, if you don't seek help, I do not know when you will be seeking help. Do not hide it. There is no taboo on this. You have not done anything wrong. You have rather helped your people in need. So there is no taboo with this. Seek help. Do not treat yourself when you are having COVID. Put yourself in the hands of somebody who knows how to treat COVID. Be vigilant. Home monitor yourself if you're doing home quarantine. Do not take steroids indiscriminately, because many people are starting steroids just by the name of COVID. Do not treat COVID indiscriminately with steroids. It is to be started only when the patient shows anything like desaturation, even if it is by walk test. Only then I steroids prescribe, not others.
Any role of SCQ, and a lot of patients come with a complaint or the suggestion they want to have advice regarding arsenic album. That's,
I will not be able to answer you on that, because yeah, really not something which I have any studies about, or nothing that I know about. HCQS prophylactic, ICMR still stands strongly by HCQS prophylaxis. So what I feel that if you are not having any contraindications to HCQS, if you do your ECG, your QTC interval is within normal limits, you are not on beta blockers, not having any cardiac problems, what is the harm going on HCQS prophylaxis? I feel you can definitely, all healthcare workers who are in active work can and should go on HCQS prophylaxis.
From that, can I request chairperson, I would say chairman, Mr. Sanket Barley, who enlightened us on this Digi Shield, because many of our doctors are inquiring, what is this? Should we go for that? So please let us know so that we equip with this Digi Shield.
Sure, Dr. Sanjay, thank you so much. Dr. Patel, nice to meet you virtually, and great sort of information that you're providing. So as we saw this pandemic unfolding and really kind of understanding this will end up into a community level, what we did is we came up with this platform called DigiShield, which is available for free to all doctors for a lifetime. Basically what it does, it gives you the ability to do something we are calling as telescreening. So an AI-based screening of that patient before that patient comes in. The platform is continuously updated with all the hotspots, containment zones, and various data. The symptomatic screening is there, behavioral screening is there. So we ask questions like, how often do you wear a mask? What sort of a mask do you wear? So we are doing sort of behavioral typing of that patient. This is also multilingual. We ask patients to submit documents, in terms of the previous case history summary. So the clinical history taking is done remotely or automatically. It's supported by our staff. So if a patient is not able to do that using their mobile phone, we can do that over the phone and get all that information for you. And using all of this information, we are alerting the doctor to a risk. Clearing that and saying high, medium, low risk is present for that patient, and helping the doctors understand a fair bit about the patient before the patient comes into the clinic. So everybody's talking about telemedicine. And so what we feel is that you need to do an AI-based telescreening, which enables you to triage that patient. And let's say you have a high risk patient that is coming in, a high carrier risk patient that is coming in, is determined by about 20 different factors automatically. Then you can, within the app, do a teleconsultation and properly remotely triage them. Let's say that you have to call that patient into your clinic, even with that risk factor. Then when they come in, you can call them at a different time. You can be hypervigilant, so you have a lot of transparency. Otherwise, what happens is the patient shows up in your OPD and you don't know, where they are from. You don't know anything about them. And your guess, it's a lot of guesswork, in terms of sort of differentially understanding the risk. The other key aspect of it is that the app allows you to do a contactless prescription. So you can either take a photo and send it securely to the patient remotely or within your clinic. It also has integrated payments involved. So before the patient gets access to the prescription, they can clear the payment process. So it's essentially designed to be as contactless as possible, even when the patient is in front of you as the clinician. So we feel that having an end-to-end solution like this, from a telescreening, a telemedicine, prescription writing, which is FDA compliant, doing sort of analytics on that prescription to help inform, potential patients that have COVID, automating the reporting to the government, and then doing contactless payments and being able to be offering that for free to doctors is of great value. And we're honored to be supporting this dialogue, with the IMA. And look forward to a further engagement. So just to answer your question, Dr. Sanjay, that is what we have done. It is available on both the Android and iOS store. And just to as a note for everybody watching the webinar, within the next 48 hours, we'll be publishing about a 15-minute summary of this webinar in a video format. We'll be also creating a checklist of all of these points and recommendations that have been suggested by the esteemed panel here, and with your review and approval, panelists will seek to distribute that, because it is very difficult for everybody to tune into a 2-hour webinar and then have a consistent takeaway and then implement that into clinical practice. So as a part of our ongoing commitment to all the doctors, we'll put all of this together, and with your help, we look forward to making this distribution of this information easy and effective.
Thank you, Dr. Sanket. Dr. Arshana Patel, Madam. concluding, I would say one sentence only. Jaan hai to jahan hai. Isliye be safe, take precautions. And I would request Dr. P.L. Deshmukh to say a vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, everybody. Hi, Dr. B.L. Deshmukh.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody. Hi, Dr. B.L. Deshmukh, Secretary, IMSCGP, Maharashtra State. I thank Dr. Bondwe, sir, Dr. Ravindra Kute, sir, and the director of IMAMS, Dr. Rajan Sanchiti, member of IMSCGP, Maharashtra State Council, for arranging this wonderful webinar for the clinicians in COVID situation. I thank Dr. Archana Pate for your presentation. I thank all the participants for watching this webinar. My thanks to Mr. Rakesh from DigiSail for arranging this event, the webinar for the IMA members. That is the need of the hour. Bondwe sir, about 270 doctors are watching this webinar on YouTube. Thank you all personally. Hope you all enjoyed this webinar and all your queries are solved. Thank you all.